asked me, he said, Kumar, India considers itself the land of Gandhi. So what is it doing testing a nuclear bomb? Now, I answered, I was young. We were a lot of discussions in the house. And I said, Mr. Glennon, whether India should or should not test the bomb is a secondary question. The primary is that a nation which has used it twice and that to kill the lakh people has no moral authority to question it. America doesn't have a moral authority to question. And I said that, and I was young, and I didn't realize the gamut of what would happen afterward. And it was just like the whole administration and him, they start going, they're like, you're anti-national, you're anti-American, you're spoiling these white kids, you're messing with his minds, you're this and that. And it became that particular moment where I, being a non-Catholic, non-white, in a 2,000 students of that all essentially were, I had a choice where I was just like, I was like, either you keep quiet and accept, or you come out and fight. And then I took this path that we come out and fight. And I actually, by the time I was 18 years old, and I was, I ended up being valedictorian of my class, but they didn't want to give me, because I was in punishment all the time, and I was always questioning and challenging, but my academic record was still strong. So generally, the people who are the valedictorian, you get a chance to speak. So I was given a chance to, I wasn't given the chance to speak because they were afraid of what I was going to say. So then the teachers supported me, and some teachers, they said, you must give Chetan the right to speak. And they're like, okay, if we're going to give Chetan the right to speak, then we have to have his speech planned. He has to practice and everything. And I remember it was a Friday night, and I practiced, I gave them my speech and everything. And it was a Friday night, and I got up on stage and I ad-libbed. I added whatever I wanted to do. I talked about how you know, the Catholic Church in the past 500 years, what it's done. Remember, it was just different. I was young, and I said, we all know, everybody knows that Jesus wasn't a white man. He was a man of color like us. So I started saying what happened to the mayor's family. And I questioned it quite a bit. They ended up turning off the mic. They ended up erasing me from the video. They ended up threatening me. And there was rumors that I'd already gotten accepted to college by that point, but there were rumors they didn't give me a diploma. But anyways, it became quite, I was always very antagonistic. I always had a very negative feeling about my college, about my high school. But then what changed that was, I don't know if you know this girl from Chicago, Ann Smettinghoff. And when I was about 10 years ago, I read about how she was from a rival Catholic school and how she went to Afghanistan and she went to provide books and teach. And she was very wanted to do good work in Afghanistan educationally. And she was killed in a bomb blast. And that really struck me that even if I had it maybe difficult in some ways in high school, there were extraordinary people in these Catholic high school. And then I started realizing that it's like, there were really a lot of good people. I shouldn't be judging the entire experience by a math teacher. So Ann Smettinghoff is somebody who's somebody I respect a lot, from Chicago, Catholic school girl who lost her life in doing a great thing. So these are the kind of things that kind of spurred me. So what I'd like to say just at the end is that we've all heard of Gandhi and Nehru. Gandhi and Nehru are like, they're the Brahminism of the Congress Party. That is the old story. Today, what is the reality in India is the Savarkar Upadhyaya, who is more of the BJP communal, hyper-nationalist, anti-minority. That is what religious minority, what is going on right now. What I say is the future is Periyar and Ambedkar, the ideas of equality. That is the future. That is what we're building. That is what is, and justice is something that we need for Dalits, for marginalized, for women, for religious minorities, for all the poor. So that is something that the Periyar model has taught us. So we are in the process of building that on the ground in Karnataka, and it's making a lot of headway around the nation. And of course, mainstream media is not really bringing that to foreground all the time because it's a corporate Brahminical kind of capitalistic media. But we have social media, we have alternative media, which is doing extraordinary work on the ground in Karnataka. So it's growing day by day. I've been involved in now for 17 years, 10 years, 11 years actively. every day is growing. And if they're putting me in jail for a tweet, it's a really harmless tweet I wrote. And actually, I questioned, it was almost like innocuous. I was struck. I was completely blown away that they're going to make such a big deal out of this. I felt it was something that their intention was to put in jail, not really to find fault, not really to like punish a wrong. It was like, let's put them in jail and let's figure out how we could do that, which is actually helping our movement in actuality, spreading the word even more. People who never knew about our ideas are like, maybe there's something there. So it's actually helping the movement. But of course, it comes with its own professional and personal risk. I'm very thankful to my parents and my wife for like standing behind it, and my brother and all everybody in the movement. But it's good things are happening. So that's why I have to say, I want to thank everybody for giving me the opportunity to speak. I want to apologize for any kind of technical problem from my side. I really apologize for it. And thanks a lot.
Thank you, Chetan. You know, audience members, please join me in a round of applause for Chetan's presentation.
Thank you.
Now, before we open the question and answer section of this presentation, I remind the audience that the Freethought Society and the American Ethical Union depend on donations to offer educational programs and speakers who enlighten and motivate. So please see the chat section of the Zoom to get a direct link to the Freethought Society and the American Ethical Union donation page. And any donation would be appreciated. And now, Jake will tell you how to participate in the question and answer session.
Thank you, Margaret. First of all, I just want to thank Chetan for first that great speech, and also for powering through sticking with some of the technical difficulties on our end. But really appreciate learning more about the background of the movement, your experience, and really hearing about how from one side of the world to the other, we're all dealing with similar challenges, and also trying to overcome them through our sheer passion of trying to make the world a better place. So it's really nice to be able to see your efforts and to see how you're fighting the good fight. So my pleasure. So to go for the Q&A portion, if you'd like to ask our speaker a question while being spotlighted, please use the reactions and raise hand function in your Zoom window. It will put you into our queue and we'll call on you in the order of hands raised. If you'd prefer not to be spotlighted rather, and would rather have me ask a question on your behalf, please send your question to me, Jake Ritter, in the Zoom chat, and I'll be happy to ask on your behalf. We actually have one question that way before got lost in the mixture. I think I actually lost the question, but I'll keep an eye out for it when it comes back up. So for anyone looking to ask a question, please raise your hand and we'll me and the fellow co-host will pick you out on a first come first serve, and you could ask Chetan himself.
I've got 100 questions, but I've got to be calling on others, so I'll wait.
Does anyone have their hand raised? Christina.
There we go.
I was curious as to what the tweet was that you...
Yeah, it was actually, so right now in Karnataka, there's a very explosive issue that is going on. And it's like, are hijabs permitted in government schools? And hijab is clearly, hijab, as you know, it's the head covering that Muslim girls wear. So it's in colleges and high schools. So it has become a communal anti-Muslim, but at the same time, Muslim identity in this communal, because Karnataka is run by the right wing state, the government. And so it's a Hindu-Muslim fight that they're tugging at. So a judge is actually, Krishna Dixit is actually determining whether hijabs should be allowed or not allowed in government school. Now, I put up a post, from 2 years ago, I wrote about this judge, and this judge actually, in a rape case, about he gives pre-arrest bail to the accused, saying the victim has slept after rape. Indian women don't sleep after rape, so she wasn't raped. So I said this is like some kind of this is 21st, this is misogyny, who is this fossil? And I just put up something back in 2020. I realized that's the same judge who's determining the hijab case. Hijab, as you know, is not just religious, it's not just cultural, it's not just educational in this context, it's not just uniformity that we're discussing, it's also a gender issue. So I put up, this guy is the same guy who's determining that case. He's made this statement in the past, attaching that tweet. Does he have the clarity required to make the right or an appropriate or judgment? Because he had the clarity required. I just put a question mark. It was a very innocuous tweet, but and actually judges in the Indian Penal Code section 21 are also public servants, but there were a lot of powerful people from the chief minister to other people, they claim, I'm not sure, and to judges, possibly executive, legislative, and judicial, who were involved in getting the police to file a suo moto case to kind of put me behind bars for 6 days, which is, you get into activism, you gotta be ready to go to jail, even if it's on spurious fabricated charges. But it's like, I realized the amazing potential of social media and how this government takes a relatively innocuous tweet so seriously, because freedom of speech, freedom of expression is being criminalized on a large level by the government in play today. And they're threatened by ideas of Periyar, who is like, and Ambedkar, who you bring to the foreground. But that was the tweet.
Thanks. I see Hans has got his hands raised.
There's one thing I wanted to add first, Hans, what Chetan was talking about really reminded me of a former senator named John Lewis talked about getting into good trouble, and it seems that's trouble. Exactly what you're doing, being able to stand by your ideals and risking it for the greater good. So that's something that just triggered in my mind.
Brilliant, Jake. We definitely believe in good trouble. We have to, like, issues of marginalized subaltern communities. You talk about untouchables and unseeables, and their struggles are never acknowledged by the mainstream media or the general public. They are the only ones fighting their fight, and they are so economically, socially, completely exploited and marginalized that their voice is not heard. We have to kind of provoke those issues as somebody who has some presence in Karnataka as a whole, as an actor. We find excuses to provoke these issues and put them on the main stage so the mainstream media actually talks about it, acknowledges it. And something like caste is completely, especially what the Dalits go through, what the Adivasis go through, what so many women in these communities go through, is never acknowledged. So we provoke. And good trouble, as you said, is something that we definitely, and John Lewis, his civil rights contribution is something we admire a lot.
Yeah, definitely. Sorry to steal your thunder, Hans. You have the floor now.
Okay, thank you. Well, Chetan, thank you very much for your presentation. I appreciate, in particular, that you introduced me to the Periyar, who's a scholar I want to learn more about. And you reminded me of something that I saw on social media, apropos to no particular topic, but it was like a graffiti on a wall that said, "Just because it doesn't happen to me doesn't mean it doesn't matter to me." And so that seems apropos to your talk today. But that leads into my particular question, which is earlier, before we were so rudely interrupted by technology misbehaving, you mentioned something about using your own privilege to disrupt your own privilege.
Absolutely. And
if I may elaborate just a bit, you know, I'm a white person. I grew up in the southern U.S., and I've become keenly aware, disappointed, and embarrassed at some of the things that my ancestors have done in this part of the country to Black and Indigenous people. And what I find is I can move in white spaces more freely, speak more freely than my Black and Brown compatriots in that work. And I'm curious to, you know, if you can elaborate a little bit more on what it means to you in your work to use your own privilege to undermine privilege.
Hans, you make a brilliant point. I've heard somebody use the term, and it's kind of funny, we're almost like cultural or inequality suicide bombers, almost as if you kind of take on your own kind of privilege, and you question it and you challenge yourself, and for the sake of a larger good, which is what Periyar does, which is as an economically privileged, as a caste. He doesn't come from the Dalits, he comes from a Shudra, which is, although it is on the bottom of the totem pole, it's not completely exploited to the same level as Dalits are. And he is obviously a man, and all these factors, he uses that to challenge that system. So even we self-question today in every single way in Karnataka. I am probably unjustly the most privileged person I know. And the privilege, obviously, we have a house, we might not be one of the richest people, you know, but in terms of education, in terms of the fact that in films, the actor's role is so relatively insignificant for the success of a film compared to the writer or director. But the writer and the director can't make a living, while I am like, I have like massive cutouts, I get a bloated salary and all these kind of benefits for somebody else's actual contribution, creative contribution, which is unjustifiably benefiting me. And of course, the caste system, which is like my generations of like educational access, my mother and father, who might not have financial benefit at the beginning, had dominant caste education, and that allowed them to go to America and we had the financial privilege. So in every way, I have been benefited by this system. And what is justice? But justice is righting the wrongs of the past. And you start to right the wrongs of the past by challenging yourself. And although you might be I'm the beneficiary of patriarchy and capitalism and education and caste system, you can challenge that for a larger good while saying, because of that privilege, I have to do more. I have to give back more. I have to put more back in. In this movement, I or my family is clearly the wealthiest in the movement, because in the movement, we have only like low income and low caste. And this is the strong and the workers and the farmers. So we put in everything financially and we should put more. And in the movement, it's led by the subaltern and the lower caste. But like, I shouldn't take up that space. They should be in that space. I should be the back support in whatever way I can. They should be leading the movement. But at the same time, this is not an identity fight. It's an ideology fight. And they means anybody with that ideology, but of course, with appropriate representation from all communities, gender, caste, class, region, linguistic, et cetera.
You have a hand up.
Yeah, if I can jump in here, because I got some of what you told me, I was just amazed to hear. And I'm trying to get a clearer view of how you are swimming in the stream in India of activism. You mentioned that only 5% of people are considered intercaste. Did I get that right?
Intercaste or interreligious marriages today are only 5%. So 95% of marriages, see, there's no love marriage is what we call, which is essentially non-arranged. Arranged marriages are the norm. And when you arrange a marriage, the families arrange the marriage. And what the families arrange the marriage, they arrange it according to their caste, on even subcaste, which is thousands of castes and subcastes. So the how caste system continues to exist today is through endogamy. Endogamy obviously means marrying within your own caste, vocational kind of tribe mindset. Now, when you have love marriages, which is obviously what we have in America, when you have those, you marry somebody you connect with, compatibility issues. But here, 95%, and even if there are love marriages, they find somebody of their own caste and get married because of that built-in kind of casteism. So 95% of the marriages statistically are within the same caste, and only 5% are intercaste, even in 2022. And Ambedkar Periyar always believed in intercaste marriages and pushed for those. And that's why Periyar set up a self-respect kind of movement and marriage setup that, like, it doesn't matter what caste or religion or economic background you come from, we have no markers, or the markers are led up to the freedom of the individual, and creates that paradigm which challenges the Brahminical caste-based marriage structure.
Amazing. Thank you. Margaret?
I raised my hand.
You got it.
Speaking of marriages, your parents shared your wedding pictures with me, and it was thrilling to know how the marriage unfolded, how your reception unfolded, the gifts you gave away. And I want you to share that with the people on this Zoom, because I was amazed.
we essentially had our marriage in a court marriage. It was a registered marriage where we married under the Special Marriage Act. So we didn't define ourselves according to any religion. And marriages in India marriages anywhere are a very big deal, but marriage in India is a huge kind of like business industry obsession. And like our kind of activism, whatever we do, I am challenged. But when we did this activism through marriage, there was very little challenging, which shocked me. I'm like, we are taking such a kind of non-religious, non-opulent, non-religious wedding, challenged through the periyarite model, challenging the system of Brahmin kind of intermediaries, Sanskrit, religion, all forms, but there wasn't very much antagonism, shockingly, because it almost was like, marriage is your call, that's your choice, and we're not gonna like mess with that, which was nice of them. But after marriage, there's been plenty of mudslinging. But even the marriage, we had it at an orphanage. We did not believe that we should have it in any kind of special place. It should be someplace where we have a meaningful connection with the people there. And there was about 50, 60 orphaned kids and a lot of older people who are neglected. We built the orphanage in many ways, the wall, we painted everything. We completely revamped the orphanage. And then we had our event there and it was a very grassroots model, and people from all across the state. I actually gave only 300 cards. We had about 3,500-4,000 people, because it was kind of a celebration for everybody from the movement that just joined in and came from all across the state and nation. And I'm really thankful that not only my parents, but Megha, who comes from an Orthodox family, who comes from a religious family, I actually told her, I said, we can't, a couple things, there's no question of doing anything religious. And I told her that, and she's like, I agree. And she convinced her parents. And that was actually, it kind of made me realize that even in the Indian marriage setup, you can question the societal norms if both partners hold strong. It's the fact that in the arranged marriage setup, the boy and the girl don't know each other, and they can't fight for what is right because the families have made this alliance. So they are subject to the kind of existing kind of unequal kind of top-down hierarchical system, superstitious system, which they play into, because first of all, they, for very many reasons, but we could do it together. And I was, and Megha and I didn't give her a ring. She asked for a ring. I said, I can't give you a ring. We don't believe in all this marker. So I didn't give her any ring. I didn't give her anything. She accepted it. But one of my favorite photographs is that she's in her Indian clothes, and as am I, in the marriage setup, and she's signing the register, and which is a very periyarite kind of revolutionary step, because never do people see a bride signing a document as her marriage. You always see it in a very kind of large scale religious kind of way. So that was something that Karnataka audience supported, and we are very inspired by Periyar thinking because of that.
But you didn't accept gifts, you gave gifts.
Yeah, we gave gifts. We didn't accept gifts. We gave an Indian constitution to everybody, a book on the Indian constitution, which made, and we had like our, we had an LGBTQ transgender woman read out our vows that we wrote. And we actually wrote three vows, which were, one was a personal vow where we said, obviously, in Indian tradition, it's like generally Hindu culture or even Indian culture. It's more like the girl is a property. She comes and she takes care of the boy's family and the boy's parents. And the question is like, what happens to the girl's parents? So clearly daughters are a liability in Indian context. So we both stood and said, we'll take care of both sets of parents. It'll be a 50-50 kind of thing. And of course, number two, that was the personal vow. The societal vow was a vow that was about eliminating all forms of discrimination and inequality to the best of our ability. And the third was a nature vow, where we obviously believed in nature, plants, all life, and nonviolence in that way. So these three vows we wrote, and a transgender woman who is an activist, and that which who are actually considered inauspicious in the Indian context. They're actually, they're considered, they're never given jobs. Their only work is sex work and begging. And so transgender, and there was a lot of criminalization of the transgender community in India up till it was removed about 3 or 4 years ago. They're like, their entire existence was criminalized, sexual habits, sexual kind of practices. So we intentionally brought in a transgender woman activist to lead that. And it was, I mean, and all the music we had was completely grassroots kind of music and everything that we did. And it was a celebration for the movement, which I was thrilled about. There's a lot to be done. And I'm very happy that a lot of people like were inspired from that. And they started doing their own kind of non-religious and giving an Indian constitution. Because today the constitution of India is an extraordinary document, especially the preamble, written by Periyar's friend Ambedkar, who was a Dalit, and it was just extraordinarily progressive. And the people who are actually fighting to retain that constitutional ethos are the people in our movement. So we claim the constitution, and we must uphold the constitution. So that is something that we gifted to all the people. And
a long time ago, a friend of mine, Babu from India, he told me that the Indian constitution actually has a clause that states it's the duty of every citizen to learn science. Is that true?
There is definitely an aspect of rational thinking that is an aspect in the constitution. It clears his rationality, but at the same time, there's a lot of, see, the document, the it's a lot of it is in the interpretation. There's a lot of kind of religious based elements in the constitution. For example, there's civil code that is based on religion. So in actuality, if you are, for example, if you are a Muslim, you will get certain religious based kind of civil liberties, that civil rights that for example, somebody who might not be, somebody who's an atheist or somebody of different religion might not get. So there's certain kinds of the constitution definitely needs we want to make it even more progressive, but it's definitely a extraordinary document, especially the preamble. It says, clearly states equality, justice, secular, socialist, which is obviously an egalitarian ideal that we try to live through, but Indian society is far from that currently, but we're working on it.
Jake, you're up. Unmute yourself, Jake.
Yeah. Yep, that helps to talk. one thing that I was really struck by, Chetan, you mentioning was taking on causes and being active voices for things that might not directly affect you, and that really reminds me of allyship and being able to be a strong ally. I was wondering, for a lot of like-minded people here, what are some of your suggestions on ways that we can best use our voices and be allies for those being greatly affected by injustices?
See, we look at everything in terms of obviously fighting the power structure that is clearly promotes and maintains inequality, class, gender, regional, linguistic, and all types of inequality. But we fight that, and how we fight that is through three clear ways. Number one, social and people interactions, whether that be social media, and mostly going out to public, see, even in today in India, a lot of people don't have, the youth do to some level have access to social media, but a lot of people in the outside the city are not in touch with social media and don't have the kind of educational skills that allows them to be connected to social media or reach on that. So you have to go to the people. So I always say to them, I say, you know, maybe Facebook, Instagram, Twitter have been maybe 20 years, something maybe. And maybe internet has been like 40, 50 years. Cinema, which is a very powerful media, but does not in any way create structural change. It's an entertainment media. It's a commercial media. I say it's been around for about 100 years, but going to the people, standing with them in their times of crisis and speaking truth to power, speaking about equality and justice has been gone on for thousands of years. So we must connect to the people by going to them. Our sphere of influence is Karnataka, which is, I told you, size of France and Italy in population and essentially size. And we go to every district, we mobilize. And that is one way of interaction, social media, people, this and that, speeches. And number two, we talk about social service. We do a lot of social service, but the social service, essentially social service consolidates the power structure. But at the same time, it's very important that we do social service because it's like, and in a counter-establishment way, because it's like it connects with the people. In India, there's a lot of, maybe everywhere in the world, there's a lot of hot air, there's a lot of talk, there's a lot of nice language that people use. But if we really want to connect with them emotionally, really want to connect with them viscerally, it's very important that you do that social work and you interact with them on a meaningful, wholesome, truly emotional connection that you have. And number three, we say, not along with social work and people's awareness, number three, the most important way of fighting the system is through activism. And we mobilize massive movements in the street, and Peria is an extraordinary inspiration for mobilizing massive movements in the street, because even his movements in Tamil Nadu in the 50s and 60s and 50s and 60s, completely thousands of kilometers away, even without media access, completely altered the power structure in Delhi, in the capital. So you don't have to be breathing down their necks. You can fight the system where you are locally and have an international impact, national impact, something that obviously Periyar shows us. So we fight in Karnataka and we come to the streets and we mobilize all groups, any marginalized, economically, socially, gender-wise, linguistic-wise, anyway, religiously marginalized. We join with them. Youth, we mobilize. Work students, we mobilize. So we basically, and we go to schools, we interact with the students. Obviously, if you look at the kind of Hindutva, which is the overarching ideology of anti-Muslim, anti-Christian kind of Hindu nationalism that is today in power, both in the center and in Karnataka, this is not something that started yesterday or the day before. For 100 years, they have worked on the grassroots. They have, I don't know if you want to say brainwashed, but they have conditioned the minds of the youth, and they have worked hard for a hate ideology. We must be willing to work harder for an ideology of love and equality and peace and goodness and something that Periyar stood for. So it'll take time. You have to be patient. We're not trying to capitalize in any way, whether it be politically or in any other way. We want just selfless good work, and there are a lot of people in Karnataka that are doing it. So these are the three ways: people's awareness, social service, and activism.
I've been wanting to ask you for a long time, ever since I got to know your parents, but have you heard of the Atheist Center in India? It was started by Gora.
By who?
Gora.
Gaurav. No, what city is it in?
I knew you would ask that, and I'm trying to find the actual name of the city. I think it starts with a K.
Kolkata. It might be Kolkata.
Yes, yes.
I thought of Kolkata. Bengal is northeast. It has a lot of progressive influence from for many hundred years. In fact, Bengal is where the British first entered in 1757, and Bengal is where a lot of opposition came out against the British. And so Bengal has been a very instrumental state in terms of politics in the past modern era. So I'm not Rabindranath Tagore, who is the one who actually was the national anthem and the first non-white to receive the Nobel Prize, if I'm not mistaken, he was actually Bengali. So Bengal has been at the foreground. I'm not surprised that they have an atheist society and that to a flourishing one. And
I think it's in Andhra Pradesh.
It's in Andhra Pradesh?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's in Andhra Pradesh. Okay, Andhra Pradesh is a nearby state. I'm surprised. That's interesting. Okay, it's in Andhra Pradesh. Then it's different. I mean, it's a neighboring state. It's also a South Indian state. But I do films in Telugu now, which is the mother tongue of Andhra Pradesh. So I'll have a look there. If you could tell me what city, I'll look it up online.
I'll send you links and so forth.
Okay, yeah. I'll definitely get in touch with them. But at the same time, it's like one thing is true. I don't know if Indians will ever, even Dalits who ironically, it's like the religion makes them inferior people. Many Dalits are, of course, religious to their own levels on different levels. So it's like the communist movement, which has promoted a lot of atheist ideas, which has been unsuccessful because they've taken up a lot of economic issues. So it's only if we take up the atheism with the anti-caste movement and with the anti-capitalist movement and the anti-patriarchal movement that we can actually mobilize all of us together. Or else it will be kind of incomplete, which is a lot of communists who have, and the communism in India is a social democratic kind of movement, has not been as successful in the 21st century as like obviously Hindutva and the BJP.
Are there any other questions? I'm looking around.
All right. Well, if you do have any questions, we can get that from you in the chat. But thanks for running the question and answer session, Jake, and for being our Zoom technician. You really overcame some hurdles this time. So thank you so much. And you were a terrific co-host tonight. And I want to take this opportunity to once again thank our speaker and special guest, Chetan Kumar Ahimsa. And it was a wonderful presentation. I'm just so proud to call you a friend now. And I hope to meet you in person someday soon.
I would love to meet you all. And I want to show you something. I want to, just 1 second. This is what I think, I don't know if you've seen Peria, but this is what he looked like.
It's fabulous.
This is what he looks like. He was, he always walked around with a cane and, This is what we keep in the main room in our house.
That's so great. My favorite Periyar story is when he was walking in a main city and he saw a statue devoted to a god, and he took off his sandal and hid it, and said, "There is no god. There is no god. There is no god at all."
Yeah, he was. And like I remember, and he had the amazing wit that when like some people threw the sandal at him, he was like he stopped it, and then he started saying more atheist minded stuff, and then the guy threw the other sandal, and then he went and picked up, like, why did you do this? He's like, what am I gonna do with one sandal? I need them both, so I can at least like use it. So he picked them both up, and he goes, so that's a very like. That's a very pediatric kind of thing that he would do. He was extremely witty and charming. And
we can't thank you enough for getting up at 5 a.m. this morning to join us. You are amazing. Well, we are so appreciative of the time you gave us, the work you do, and the education you provided. We at the Freethought Society very much enjoy providing Zoom presentations, and there's more to come. The Freethought Society next event will take place on Saturday, April 30th, 2022. We are hosting author and podcaster Seth Andrews at 11:45 a.m. Pacific Daylight Time, 2:45 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. So please see the description of the April event at the Freethought Society meetup page and or the Freethought Society website. Now, Jake is going to tell you about the next American Ethical Union event.
Thank you, Margaret. The next American Ethical Union event is happening on Sunday, March 13th at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. One of our societies, the Riverdale Yonkers Society for Ethical Culture, is hosting an event titled Hate Crimes, Violence Against Asian Americans, and Policing with special guest Kai Zhang. If you're interested in attending, please check out our website to learn more, and we really hope to see you there.
Well, I just want to say one thing. I really wish you guys definitely visit India, and there's so much to experience, to learn, love. And when you do visit, please drop me an email. I'll come and see you wherever you guys are. And we will definitely see how we could go through this. I don't know. See, I my parents want me to come to America for a little bit, but if I leave the country, they might not let me in back in.
Right.
Really?
So there's some threats here and there. So I'm not going anywhere. I don't know if they're going to throw me out physically, but if I go, I don't know if they'll let me in.
Lucky.
So that's why I don't know if I'll come to America, but please do come to India. And it's an extraordinary place.
Well, for those who would like to stay to socialize, we'll take a 5 to 10 minute break and you can come back and meet us here. If you're leaving the room to refresh, please turn up the volume of your device to enjoy the break music. It's provided by Abraham Steve Mackey. And he is going to be singing John Lennon's Imagine. And this is dedicated to you, Chetan.
Thank you.
Thank you. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell. Below us, above us, only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for. No religion to. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will be as one. Imagine no possessions. Wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. Brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will live as one.
Thanks again, Margaret. And I'm going to head out. Jake and Hugh, thanks a lot again.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chetan. Thanks for sticking around.
Thanks a lot. Bye, Christine. Bye, Hans.